Welcome to Sunday Morning Worship with the First Presbyterian Church of Ithaca, New York. I'm Pastor Kirianne. Wherever you're tuning in from, we hope that you have a comfortable seat, a good memory of church fellowship to set in your imagination, and something for which to thank God. Starting this week, we are having only morning prayer at 9 a.m. together, and it's very easy to join us if anybody would like to. We have a Zoom meeting, and you can click in from our website, or you can dial in from a phone. This past week, we sent out our first midweek email devotional. If anybody wants to get those and didn't, we have an email list, and you can email the address that you see at the bottom of your screen. That's Linda Sharp, as the office administrator working from home, and she can add you to our email list, which will include you in other kinds of things too, like worship links for Sunday morning. All of these pieces of information are available on our website and also on our church Facebook group and on the Facebook page. And so there are lots of ways for us all to stay in contact, and we hope that you will all join us. Suzanne organized a children's activity this past week, and there are ways that people can participate in the children's time. And we also love always hearing from people who would like to participate in our worship service. There are always lots of parts to go around. Take a deep breath and let us join together in prayer and in singing and in thinking and in being with God, in whom we live and move and have our being. Let us worship God.
Worship.
God is named Emmanuel. God is with us.
We are not alone.
We are a people in communion.
As close to one another as the matter of one body.
Gathered now at any distance, we are here in God's name.
So let us not doubt this, nor pretend in our hearts we are alone.
We are together in Christ, united in love.
As one family in the Spirit, let us worship God.
Here we are again, another week of physical separation. It's a situation caused by something we can't see, but we believe in it because there is proof. People are getting sick. There are coughs and rashes and fevers, and sometimes even death. We may not like the effects, but it's the kind of proof we so often need in order to believe what we cannot see. It's the kind of proof we often ask for from God. And even though we may do it in a joking manner, saying, "Dear God, if you would just send a small lightning bolt, just a little one, to land next to my neighbor's feet, who keeps extending his fence further and further onto my property, just to let him know it's not okay." We may be joking, but we probably wouldn't mind if that were to happen. Or a smaller prayer that says, "Oh, dear God, please help me pick the winning numbers in the Powerball lottery. I won't ever ask for anything again." But that would be lovely if you would do that. Or on more mundane issues, such as, "We've had enough grayness. Dear God, please send a sunny day." And while we don't expect for the sun to immediately pop out and the gray clouds to go away, wouldn't it be lovely? That would be proof that God has heard our prayer. And so often we ask and want this proof rather than noting that it is all around us. The cycle of water. The rains do come down. And the plants grow. The rivers flow. Water evaporates. The clouds expand. And the rain comes again. What a miracle. People whom we have loved and who have loved us through the years. Or even the smaller bits of love that we might not think about. The stranger whom we pass as we're walking along the sidewalk with our masks. The stranger who steps way out and into the grass in order to give us the separation that keeps us safe. It may be that they're doing it for their sake, but perhaps they are thinking about you too and caring about your welfare. More often than not, though, we just need to be quiet enough. For brief periods even, so that we can let ourselves feel God's presence. In silence now, we ask God to forgive us for the many times that we have asked for proof of God's love and care for us. Amen. Friends, at the end of our confessions, the sound of the amen, we are not given a big bright red F to wear in our shirts, proof that we are among the forgiven. Instead, we've been given a clean heart that does not need to be troubled by our past. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And now turn to another. Whether the others are present in the room with you or are in your hearts, though distant, and offer the peace that comes with forgiveness, and then accept the peace that they and Christ offer to you. The peace of Christ be with you all. Peace.
What do you experience when you have your eyes closed?
I'm in darkness. Yep, I'm in darkness.
Is that it?
Definitely in darkness.
Are you
and sometimes when there's sun, I can see the sun.
Even though you have your eyes closed?
Uh-huh. I can see. The sunlight comes right through my little eye.
I have these colors. I have the same colors. And you want to soften it or you want to darker? Okay. And now I'm done. Actually, they're quite good.
I can look in the mirror.
But how can you look in the mirror if you have your eyes closed? What would you see?
I smell it and hear it.
You smell yourself in the mirror?
No. Yeah. I smell myself in the mirror and I hear it.
How did it feel to have your eyes closed versus your eyes opened?
It looked quite easy, but I didn't know where the spot is. Yeah, and let me do another thing. Okay, I'm gonna do the different kind. Done. I did quite. It's okay. Anyways. So, look what my picture done. And the first one is here. The second one is here.
Did it feel different having your eyes closed?
Yeah, I did.
How? Can you explain it? Can you use your words? Yeah, please.
So, when your eyes closed, you can't see anything. And when your eyes open, you can see. Mm-hmm. It's just like when you have to do homework and you're closing your eyes and you're doing the wrong side and you're just messing up your homework. So we have to keep our eyes open when you do homework. We could do anything when we are drawing. So remember, you could do anything you want. And the most thing that's hardest you want to do is drawing with your eyes closed. So bye, everyone.
Welcome to the children's sermon. How do you know something? Or better yet, how do you learn something to know something? I came up with a few answers. Since you're not here, I can't hear you. But what I thought of was reading or going to a teacher, someone who knows something very well, to ask for advice or about something. And from my own experience, if I try something, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But then there's something how we know something that we don't learn. It's an innate wisdom. We can even call it intuition or a sense. And in the Bible verse that you're going to hear today, it says the companion of the Spirit of Truth. And this truth is the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit resides within us, in our own bodies. And so for us to be receptive and to pay attention to this sensation, I want us to awaken our body. It's one way that we can stay close and to keep feeling the Holy Spirit in us. So I called on a teacher to help me, Maurice, who is the master of Tai Chi at our church. And he gave me the five S's, so we're going to use four of them. So I need everybody to stand up tall, okay? So first, we're going to shake. You can just bounce up and down, or you can shake your hands, or you can shake a leg. You decide how you want to shake and move this morning, okay? The other one is stomping. So you can stomp your feet, or you can tap, going right into that heart center. And then you can swirl. So this is our fourth swirl. Or maybe you wanna work with your head and your shoulders. Sometimes if you're in school and you're doing Zoom calls, oh my gosh, so much sitting, right? So these are nice little movements to open you up. And then you have your swinging. So you can swing. Or maybe this way you want to swing. And then come to stand right in the center. So be really steady on your feet. Bounce your knees a little bit so they're relaxed. And then bring your hands right in front of you, about 6 inches apart. And we're going to do this first with our eyes open. So I want you to just inhale, pull your hands apart. And exhale, push them together. So you're not touching them, But I want you to feel this little ball that you're holding, this ball of energy from a magnetic field that we just awakened in our bodies from moving. So you inhale and you exhale. And now close your eyes. And as your eyes are closed, as you inhale, pull them apart. See how big the ball can be where you keep feeling it between your hands. And then exhale, bring the ball to center to make it small. And you can put one hand on top, noticing how that changes it. The other hand on top. And then come back to stillness right in the center. And notice if that movement or that sensation felt different with your eyes closed. And so we close our eyes to allow us to turn inward. So bringing our hands now into that prayer right at the heart center, bringing our chin down so we can turn off our ears to the outside world and our eyes are already closed. But we're bringing all of our attention to the center of the chest. And so now let us pray. Dear Lord, let us feel you from a deeper place of wisdom. Let us reside in the mysteries and the places where we do not understand. Let us come to you in prayer and speak from the spirit of the heart, or that place of our companion of truth. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
You want it together? Good job!
Wait, smile, sit, ready. Sit up, breath.
Do you want it together?
I'm ready.
Oh, okay. Ready? I am the church.
You are the church. We are the church together. All who follow Jesus, all around the world. Yes, we're the church together.
The church is not a building. The church is not a steeple. The church is not a resting place. The church is the people. I am the church.
You are the church. We are the church together.
All who follow Jesus, all around the world. Yes, we're the church together.
This morning's scripture reading is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 22 through 28. Paul has been preaching on the Greek peninsula to the many cities there, and he's just arrived in Athens. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship is unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God, and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he indeed is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. And even some of your own poets have said, 'For we too are his offspring.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This is a reading from the Gospel according to John, chapter 14, verses 15 to 20. "If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you desolate. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me, because I live, you will live also. In that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you.
Let us pray. O Lord our God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you alone are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. My son Liam, as a part of homeschool the other day, asked, how many senses do we have? And there's a long, rich history of parents answering their children's questions in far too complicated ways. How do we define a sense? Some people think that we have five, but there's a possibility that we have more. It all depends on how you take the word. I think he rolled his eyes a bit. But it's worth thinking about. How do we define a sense? Well, it's input to our brains. Every sense is understood because our brains perceive it. There's no color in nature, for instance. Nature has frequency and the reflection of light, and our brains turn that frequency into color, but color does not exist. There's not even really shape when you think about it. Take a flower, one of the beautiful moments of spring. It reflects rays of light in a range of frequencies in every direction, like a light bulb. We only perceive it as having a shape because we have this lens in our eye that redirects only some of those rays into a pattern on our cornea. But the object itself is radiant, not closed, not framed, not contained. We, behind our lenses, can perceive its edges. But in nature, it sends its light in every direction at once, like a sprinkler, like an explosion, like a disco ball, like a sun. Sense is what we perceive about the world around us. Traditionally, through science, we say that there are five senses. This is what my son wanted me to say. This is what his teacher wants to hear. Even science recognizes some additional senses. We have pineal glands, tiny little pine cone-shaped things inside of our midbrain that sense whether the world around us is bright or dark, even when our eyes are closed, even when we have no vision per se at all. Our pineal gland is alert to the environment. Scientists call it a vestigial eye that measures and keeps time. A non-visual ocular photoreceptive pathway. Reptiles and amphibians actually have a third eye on the top of their head that feeds this organ. It's a sense, but it's one that we don't pay much attention to. And yet, René Descartes called it the principal seat of the soul. Are our immune systems a sense? When faced with a novel virus, and yes, this is very apropos stuff, our immune systems respond to something. The brain's neurotransmitters play a part in this, activating and strengthening the system that creates an immune response inside of us. The response is targeted, specific, and learned. The immune response and our pineal rhythms are normally subconscious. But does that mean that they are not senses? I wondered what my 9-year-old son thinks. I wonder what you think. There's fertile ground to think about our senses when it comes to our faith. I believe, and you've heard me say this before, that God comes to people through people, at least whenever possible, whenever we are willing to be partners in God's work. But There have been a few times in my life that I have found God bypassing the normal channels of the five senses and speaking to me in a different way. I have had dreams that have had more meaning to me than just self-reflective visions. I heard a command once that led me to my cat who had just been hit by a car. I had no knowledge of this. Some dismiss such experiences as paranormal or extrasensory or nonsense. Note that last term. But what if they are a sense, a rare experiential sense through which God reaches us and connects to us and speaks to us? Maybe you could define a sense as anything that's not self-generated. The Bible tells stories of the rare times that God came to people in a sensory way. A burning bush, a pillar of smoke, a voice on a mountaintop, a message to a prophet. Sons and daughters who prophesied, the elderly who dreamed dreams, and the young ones who saw visions. A spirit in the water of baptism, a man who walked among us. A command over the wind and the waves, a darkened sky at a moment of grief, and a rent curtain, and a shaking of the earth beneath their feet. A rolling away of a stone, a vision that broke and shared bread, an ascension, a tongue of flame, a revelation. But some of these seem to walk a line between sense and nonsense. We hear God speak to someone, but the text says no one else heard it. We read of Jesus teaching the people, and yet only some could understand. He looks at someone, and they see him in a different way, or some spirit within them does. Samuel hears a voice. But Eli keeps saying, "I did not call you. Go back to sleep." Yet Samuel heard something, and eventually he answers, not a human voice, but God's. Is that a sense? Is it an experience we take in, like taste or touch, that we can have because there is a capacity within us that can connect us with God, that can cause us to modify our lives, adjust our thinking, enlarge our perception, something that can gratify us with meaning, that can fill us with hope, that can make us feel like more? Do such experiences make sense to us, or is it all just nonsense? Paul climbed up to the top of the Areopagus, overlooking all of Athens, where a statue stood that was dedicated to an unknown god. And he spoke to the Athenians about the difference between a god that eludes the senses and one that can be known and held in relationship and loved. "What, therefore, you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you," he said. "The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands. Indeed, God made us so that we would search for God, and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being." God is so close to us, and we have the ability to know God like the world around us. Jesus said of God, "The world neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you." Perhaps we can think of this as a sense. Perhaps not. But it is worth thinking about, isn't it? Whether we have access to more than we normally acknowledge. Whether our sense of connection now is a real communion in Christ. Whether there isn't more to creation as God's own art than meets the physical eye. So ends this message. Nothing more than photons on a screen, of no mass, moving too fast to be measured. But yet, all the same, a moment between us. All of our senses are magic. To God the artist be the glory. Amen.
Christ Jesus, child of Mary, God with us, King and suffering servant, high priest and Lamb of God, teacher and word, living, suffering, dying, and rising again, you challenge, redeem, and restore us. Holy Spirit, breath of life, counselor and comforter, fire of God, you inspire, sustain, and purify us. Forming us in the nature of Christ, transforming us with your gifts. You bind us together in one body, your church. God of all creation, made known to us in Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit, Your boundless love exposes our rebellion and greed. A mother who will not abandon her child. A father who welcomes the prodigal home. You forgive, accept, and embrace us, and call us into loving communion forever. In life and death, we belong to you. Everlasting God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you are with us in every step we take, and for this we are thankful. It's been difficult for us these last many weeks because our steps have been confined to such small areas that we have not been able to be your hands and feet in the world in the ways we are accustomed. Even so, we have not forgotten that prayer is always available, and though separated by distance, we sit as one this morning, and hold our sisters and brothers throughout the world in prayer. The virus that is keeping us separated from each other has no knowledge of boundaries on a map, and has infected millions worldwide. For the health of all your children, we pray, no matter the source or cause of illness and injury. For comfort for the grieving, we pray, and with gratitude we pray for all who are offering the care for the ill and the injured. This morning we stop and remember that even though this virus has grabbed most of the headlines, there are other needs to be tended. Where there is violence, we ask for peace. Where there is injustice, we ask for justice. And where there is hate, we ask not only for love, but also for a boundlessly growing appreciation of the many differences among us, each one of us having been made in your image. And as we look out on the world from our homes, though the view seems limited and shortened, we ask that you help us rejoice in the beauty of the world around us, forever knowing your presence. We ask all this as we join in one voice to say the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
thank you for joining us in this time of worship. It's been good to be together. We are told as a commandment to honor the Sabbath and to make time for God, but we're commanded to do this because it's good for us. It makes us better. It makes us feel better. It makes us do better. And this is a time in life when we all have a chance to do better for one another together. So let us spend not just Sunday morning, but all of our days and all our lives worshiping God. May the God of peace and new life bring us new life today. Amen.